Blog Talk Radio.
Hello, hello, everybody, and welcome to the Goddess Suite. Who would we have on the line tonight?
Sister Love is in the house tonight.
Hello, Sister Love. How are you doing?
I said I'm looking forward to the show tonight.
I am too, all about birthing, holistic birthing versus conventional birthing. And as always, before we get started, we always like to dedicate a song to our topic for tonight. So I picked a great song, which I love, love, love. It's called A Song for Mama by Boyz II Men. So give us a couple of minutes. Sit back, sit for your tea, listen to a little bit of Boyz II Men, and the Goddess Suite will be right back.
Yes, it is.
All right. Welcome back to the Goddess Suite. Don't you guys just love that song? Oh, my gosh.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
I'm telling you.
Right. Well, once again, this is Holistic Gals, and I want to say thank you, everybody, for joining the Goddess Suite. And I'm going to let Sister Love introduce our wonderful guest tonight.
All right. Hello, everyone. This is Sister Love of Love Yourself Nutrition Coaching. Without further ado, I want to introduce our guest, Omitola. She is a fantastic spiritual holistic doula and creator of the new ebook, Womb Magic, which contains information on healing, healing mentally, physically, spiritually, emotionally, and, So, yes, without further ado, we're going to have our guest on to discuss the conventional giving birth conventionally or holistic natural, which is more beneficial for mother and child. So we have an expert on the line. Without further ado, Sister Omitola, welcome.
Greetings, greetings. How are you?
Greetings.
Greetings, Sister. Thank you for coming.
My blessing. Thank you for inviting me.
You are so welcome.
Mm-hmm.
Oh,
absolutely.
Right.
We're humbled.
Yes.
Oh, it's our pleasure for you to be on our show, and we just want you to get into the topic of tonight and just introduce yourself and what do you do.
Okay. Well, my name is Omitola. Some call me Mama Omi, and I am the owner and founder of Divine Waters Womb Wellness, Divine Mystics, the Mbutu Birth Workers Collective, and as the sister said, the eMAGAZINE Womb Magic, which is scheduled for launch at the end of this month. And so my main focus is dealing with care for women in a holistic manner, and I always start with the spiritual aspect of it because I work under the awareness that everything starts in the spiritual body. So
yeah,
I start from the inside out. So my specialty is womb work, and that includes birthing. I'm a doula, as was mentioned, as well as a midwife apprentice. And that's basically it.
Okay.
Well, awesome. Can you tell us a little bit about yourself and about how you got started on your spiritual journey on becoming a doula?
Actually, I didn't even know I was going to become a doula. Even when I started my spiritual journey, I didn't know what a doula was. I am a daycare provider. I have a degree in early childhood education, and so I owned and operated a family daycare both in the D.C. area, and then when I relocated to Georgia, I continued to work with children. As my children got older, you know, I began to want to look into something else, and I kept seeing this word doula. I'm like, well, what the heck is a doula? And so I looked it up, and, you know, I was fascinated by it, at the idea of, you know, working with women who are pregnant, because I had all of my children the conventional way, you know. So it was fascinating to me, this idea of not having to do that. So I took the certification course, and I attended my first birth, and I became a belly junkie. So it became, you know, a passion for me, and it's kind of along my path. I've always, you know, people have always looked at me and automatically called me mama. I don't know why, but everybody I know calls me mama. And so it just kind of, you know, I've always worked with children. I've always worked with families. And then, so doing this just became like a natural progression for me.
Oh, wow. Oh, that's beautiful. Can you tell us the spiritual aspects or the spiritual makeup of the womb?
Oh, that's a good one. The womb has a brain of its own. The womb has it collects emotions, it collects experiences, it collects events. It's a for women, the womb can be a source of creativity. It can be a source of, you know, that birthing. It can be a source of, you know, being connected to your feminine energy. That's when it's in balance. When it's not in balance, it rebels. And through that rebellion, you get the menstrual cramps. You get the womb, you know, the various womb diseases, because what it's doing is it's saying, hey, I need attention. A lot of times when we talk about, you know, losing weight and getting healthy and all this other stuff, okay, we're going to go to the gym, okay, we're going to do this, we don't really pay attention to the health of our womb. That's not something that's really been put to the forefront for women. We pay attention to our womb for two reasons. A, we want to make sure we got our period. And then thank you. Number two is clean, because you don't want, I'm telling you.
Okay.
So other than that, you know, you really don't pay attention to what's going on, you know, with stuff that's happening down there, you know. So,
yeah.
And, you know, then we as women wonder why we are so out of balance, and that's because, you know, there's an old, I can't remember who said, if it was the Mayans, but it's an ancient proverb that says when the womb is out of balance, the whole woman is out of balance.
Mm.
You know, that is the source of who we are. Now, you know, granted, there's a whole lot of things going on within the feminine body, but, you know, when you think about a woman, that is a main symbol of that femininity. And we are connected to that creation cycle because it is creation that is, you know, reborn through us.
Mm-hmm.
So it's very important that even prior to thinking about getting pregnant, well, let me put it this way. Once you've thought about getting pregnant, you're mm-hmm. pregnant. I believe on that spiritual realm, it's already done. So
right.
Therefore, what has to be done are preparations in order for that conception to take place in time and space. And so it's very important that women take time. Both, you know, there has to be time to pick out a proper mate. There has to be time to do that cleansing, not just, you know, for the woman, but also for the man. It's very important because he passes things on through his sperm. He does pass on womb trauma because they hold that trauma within their prostate, and womb traumas pass down from both the paternal and the maternal side, from, you know, the grandmother, great-grandmother, and the mother. And so
right.
men carried in the womb also get that womb trauma, but, you know, for them, the prostate is like the masculine version of the womb. So that energy gets held in their prostate. So then, you know, for them, you're looking at prostate cancer. You're looking at, you know, problems with being able to have and maintain an erection, you know, their sexual energy and things like that. So it's very important that, you know, as we get together, we learn how to do this cleansing, and we learn to, you know, come together and mate properly
mm-hmm.
and not just sporadically. We got too many oops babies running around. you know, we got too many, that's why I said, you know, you pay attention to your period, and then your period don't come, and the first thing you say is oops, you know,
mm-hmm.
and then the first thing the other one say is wasn't me. So now you got a whole other situation
yeah.
going on,
right.
and that's what you want to prevent.
Right.
That's right.
The denial mm-hmm. and all of that stuff, you know.
Exactly.
We don't realize how spiritual actually our wounds are. So, like, I heard the womb is actually another spirit within the woman. And I know I was going through some issues, and I had to do breathing exercises for my womb because I could feel her upset. And
mm-hmm.
I actually did breathing exercises, Qigong, and focused on my womb. So
mm-hmm.
we really have to recognize the spirituality and the power of our wombs and pay attention to her, because she is speaking to us.
Oh,
so.
Absolutely. And she's a feisty something, because if you
yeah.
don't pay attention, she'll say, oh, really? It's like that? Well, let me show you what
yeah.
I got for you.
Yeah.
you know, and then exactly. And so we really want to make sure that we're doing her honor. So you not only want to hear her spiritually, but you also want to eat in a way that benefits her. So that's making sure that you are eating foods that balance the endocrine system. You want to make sure that you are doing the one thing that I teach. You know, I do womb divination, womb readings, which means, you know, I help people to understand where their womb trauma comes from. And so we, you know, I help them to understand the generational trauma that's really embedded or encoded into their, you know, their cells, and to help them release that, and to even help them uplift the their ancestors in a way of when you promote that healing. And so, you know, we do the energy healing, we do the breathing, we do the womb meditations, I have them do journaling. I even have them, if possible, to speak to their mothers and grandmothers and tell them about their experience while being pregnant with that person.
Interesting. Yeah. You know, wow. And it's so amazing how we pass things along. So I see through our DNA, even like things that the mother ate while she was pregnant, because, you know, I noticed that, like, my mother, she loved almond joys. And then I know when I came of age, I started to love them too, didn't know why, but I know it's connected because, you know, certain foods your parents eat, you know, you take on and you like them too. And, you know, and then the fact that you... the mother might have craved these particular foods. It's just, all of this is...
Yeah. And can I ask you, Mommy and Omi, why is it that our wombs and our reproductive system are so closely related to our mother?
Very simple. That's the womb that you came through.
Okay.
Everything that your mother... felt emotionally, the anger, the joy, the passion, the whatever experiences, you were feeling that also. While you were being, you know, while you're doing your thing in the womb, you're feeling everything that she goes through. You can hear the laughter. You can hear the anger. You know, when the baby is in the womb, they can hear what's going on. They can tell the difference already from the womb. In their, you know, their mother's voice and their father's voice, you know. And when these babies are born, you can kind of get an idea of the type of womb they came through. Because I have seen mothers who stress a lot and have gone through a lot of things, and they birth a baby that, you know, is sometimes very restless.
Mm-hmm.
And then I have witnessed women who have had, you know, a good experience. You know, whether or not they were with the mate, you know, they had a good experience, though. They took caution and care, and the baby comes out, you know, calm, like, okay, let's get this started. So it really, you know, we're very closely connected to our mother's wombs because that is the womb that we came from. That is where we got our genetic makeup. You know, that is what sheltered us. For those months in there, that's where we our nurturing began.
All right, yeah. Because I noticed that my mom and my grandmother and my aunt all share issues with their womb, like fibroids. I think my grandma and my aunt had like hysterectomies or partial hysterectomies. My mom had issues with her womb. Now, I didn't because, well, I actually did have an issue, but I to nutrition to rectify that, you know, to fix that. And but also I noticed that my mom is fertile and I am fertile. So it's like that connection with the women in our specific spiritual, the womb, like that is like amazing. So...
absolutely, absolutely, because even with, you know, my mother, my birth mother had a hysterectomy. When I got to around the same age that she had her hysterectomy, I had a partial hysterectomy.
Mm-hmm.
which is one of the reasons why I'm so passionate about womb health, because I don't want anybody to have to go through what I went through that led me to have the hysterectomy. I would not doubt, I never knew my grandmother, I would not doubt that she had womb issues as well. And, I hear some of the stories about my mother's relationship with her mother, and it was not good.
Mm-hmm.
My mother passed away when I was young, so I didn't get a chance to form a relationship with her. But I hear some of the trauma that happened in her life. And even though I was not raised by her or able to, really get to know her, my life has mimicked her life in many areas. My mom had domestic violence. She lived through domestic violence. I lived through domestic violence. My mom experienced homelessness. I experienced homelessness. My mom had, some issues with her feminine energy. I had issues with mine. The only difference is, my sister was terrified when I went in for my partial hysterectomy, because what she saw was history repeating itself, and she didn't think I was going to come back out the hospital. I did. So right at that point, I knew that the cycle had been broken, and it was time for me to continue to break that cycle. So healing had to take place. And
right.
I tell women who don't have, who had a hysterectomy, who don't have a physical womb, that you still have that spiritual essence that is there. And so healing needs to take place, because when you don't heal, if it's not able to attack that particular physical organ, it's going to migrate somewhere else, because your body is trying to tell you, hey, the spirit is talking, you're not listening, it's knocked on the door, so now we just going to start doing stuff to mess you up.
Uh-huh.
Until you finally sit down and pay attention. And so even when you look at people's lives and you see last year they had financial issues, and here we come around the same time of year, they got financial issues, and you start looking at them like, dude, I notice every year you got these issues, because they never resolve the problem. So you continue to experience what you have to experience until you say, okay, now it's time for me to make some changes. So all of us really are living a cycle of insanity, because we're trying to do the same thing over, we're doing the same thing over and over again and trying to solve it the same way, instead of saying, okay, it didn't work this way. So now it's time for me to step out of the box. And a lot of us are scared to step out of that box, because one of the things that we have to do in the process of womb healing is you have to realize some truths about yourself.
Amen.
And you don't want to have to hear truth about yourself, especially when you're hearing it from yourself, and you can lie to everybody else around you, but you can't lie to yourself.
Mm-hmm.
Exactly. I've tried. It don't work. My enemy said, really? We gonna do that? Okay. So when you have to face truths about yourself, you have a choice. You can either continue the same pattern, or you can step up and start to make changes. And once you step up and start to make changes, I'm not saying your life is going to be easier, but you start to create, you start to put tools in your toolboxes to handle certain situations. You learn how to handle things better. I tell everybody that I know, I ain't been Mama Omi all my life now. I'm not going to sit there and tell that lie. It's been a journey.
Mm-hmm.
I got some stories to tell y'all to make you want to go home and slap somebody, but that's for another show. But, I haven't been Mama Omi all my life. I've been through some things. I've seen some things. I've smelled some things. I've witnessed some things. And
right.
So, but all of these things were part of my journey. So when we look back at our journey and we carry shame with us, what you're doing is you're tearing yourself apart even more. I'm not saying we have to glorify these things, but there should be no shame, because we all come into the world, we all get caught up. It's about being able to break that whatever tie that holds us and to grow beyond that. So don't hold shame. You can't learn anything from shame. You have to realize that even the worst experience was the greatest opportunity for you to learn about yourself and rise above it.
Wow, that was very beautiful, and very necessary to say, because we do get caught up. It's so easy to get caught up. But that was beautifully put.
Thank you.
I wanted to ask a question. Can you talk about how you can start to begin to honor your womb?
Absolutely. First thing you say is, I'm going to honor my womb.
Okay.
Then you start to put things into place that help you. See, I like to keep things simple. I don't profess to have any magic words or anything like that. First, you just have to put in your mind that, doggone it, I'm going to do it.
Thank God.
And then you have to. And then you have to step up to the plate. So you have to be willing to allow yourself to be open to receive information. And not everything out there is going to work for you, and that's okay. So just because, like you said, you did the breathing and the Qigong, that may not be their level just yet. I may say, oh, we're going to do this, and that. So we got to make sure that you can receive it at a level that you can receive it. So first, we're just going to talk about, maybe we'll just journal. Let's talk about some of the things that you've been through. So that's always a good step for anybody, because if somebody has really experienced some trauma, they may not feel comfortable right off the bat stepping into a sister circle and sharing all their business. And that's fine, because we all grow up, or we all go through life with the mentality that I'm the only one experiencing this. So I don't want to go to a sister circle and tell people my business, and they look at me like I'm crazy. So, you know, one of the things that you could do is go ahead and start journaling. That journal is for nobody but you.
Right.
So nobody has to look at that journal. So if you are going through something one day and you just need to release and you need to vent and you need to, you know, put it out there, then by all means, let that journal be your sacred place. Let that journal be your comfortable space. And then once you get to a level where, you know, you're ready to start venturing into some other things. Now, I'm going to tell you, for me, it wasn't the journaling. What happened for me is I changed my diet.
Wow.
And who would have known that changing my diet would have opened up a whole bunch of other stuff, because my sister introduced me to eating vegan. And she said, oh, goodness, this is going to open you up spiritually. And I'm thinking, how the hell is me not eating meat going to open me up? I don't even understand how you putting two and two together right now. But it did. You know, it really did. So
right.
I started, the first thing that I did was I took a Reiki class.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and that helped me. And then I'm like, okay, well, what else is out there? So everything that I did, because I am a Reiki practitioner, I do this, all these wonderful, and we don't need to go into it, modalities that I learned that I now do on other people. But I started just to learn for myself.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't take these classes originally to say, okay, I'm going to take a Reiki certification and I'm going to go and work on some people, make some money. I took Reiki first to learn how to heal myself.
Mm.
So find things that interest you. You know, once you do the journaling, talk to people. So if Qigong might interest you, go take a Qigong class.
Mm-hmm.
You know, learn that breathing. If Tai Chi, yoga, you know, learn these things and then find which one is comfortable for you. Or at least, I won't say learn, try them. And then find which one is comfortable for your spirit, and then keep going. And then allow yourself to grow. One thing that I tell people is, you don't worry about the sister next to you and where they are. You don't worry about the sister in front of you and where they are. You mind your own path.
Mm-hmm.
And do what you're supposed
your
to be doing.
I love it.
Exactly. Because
yes,
I tell people, you may not be where you ought to be. You may not even be where you think you should be. But Lord have mercy, thank the good Lord you ain't where you were yesterday.
Amen.
So,
you bring me to the choir tonight, boy.
So, you So I just tell sisters, folks, don't worry about trying to be in a competition, but also surround yourself. When you're ready, start surrounding yourself with like-minded sisters. I feel sisterhood is so important. And I tell people all the time, and I shout it from the mouth, I got one of the best sister circles in the world. I am in heaven. I got sisters who will put me in my place when I need to be. They will lift me up when I need to be lifted up. They support me. We run business ideas. We help support each other. Well, I mean, this is my sister circle. And so I love them. And when you find yourself a good sister circle, you have created such a circle of empowerment. Now, I've said it before, and I'm going to say it again. If you're the smartest one in your group, you need a new group.
Right.
Don't hang around folks that ain't got no
sense.
Okay? So you want to be around people that got good sense. If they don't know what 2 times 2 is, then you need to go and mind your business and find somebody else who can take you to the next level. So, you know, that's one of the problems. We hang around people, you know, don't close the door on anybody because everybody needs their journey and they're going to have their awakening. So I'm not saying close the door on people. But sometimes you got to love folks from a distance.
Yeah.
You know, sometimes there's some folks you got to love through email. You know what I'm saying?
Especially when you're trying to work on yourself.
Exactly. And you may have those around you. Oh, why are you doing that? You know, what you
it's
doing that for? Yes, exactly. So you have to put yourself around because this path can be lonely if you don't have like-minded individuals or at least open-minded individuals who will at least love you enough to say, baby, if it works for you, tell me what I can do.
Right. That's beautiful. Yeah, I just want to take that moment to give thanks for my sister circle, for my goddesses. I love you, ladies.
Yes.
Take that moment. Thank you. Thank you. I have gratitude and grateful for my sister circle.
I'm going to say something that my son told me today. He said, I love us.
There you go. There you go. I love me some us. There you go.
There we go. You have to. I mean, you have to embrace it and just be thankful for, you know, people that's going to just keep it real with you because that's the way, that's how we're able to evolve on this journey, you know? Mm.
Absolutely. So,
Mama, I have a question for you.
Mm-hmm.
I have a son, and so I went through labor and delivery. What do you think about this rule they have with no food, no drink while giving birth? What is up with that?
Because they're worried about you vomiting. But here's the thing. I've seen women vomit on empty stomachs. Here's the thing. You can eat. When I'm working with a woman and if we're doing a home birth, they can eat all throughout the pregnancy. I mean, all throughout the birthing process. But, you know, early in the birthing process, when it's the early stages where it's cute and you're starting to feel a little contraction here and there, yeah, you can eat, you know, your regular meal. But when we start getting closer and closer into contractions, we want to eat something lighter, so a broth, or maybe nibble on some graham crackers. Have some. One of the reasons why they don't want you to drink is because they want to keep the bladder as empty as possible, because that can cause issues with the baby being able to drop properly. So then we look at shifting from liquids, you know, to ice cubes. If they don't have ice cubes, then we do sips with the liquids. But you can eat. Now you're going to get to the certain part of the birthing process where you're not going to be thinking about food. But we want you to keep your energy up. So yes, you can eat, but hospitals are funny. Some hospitals are okay with it. I've seen hospitals where they've told the husband to run down to the cafeteria and get him. I've been in the birthing room where the mama was eating grits. So, you know, and I've been in a birthing room where we had to wait for the nurse to turn her head and slip mommy a little bit of graham cracker. So it really depends on, you know, when you're at a hospital, the type of, you know, the policies and the staff that you're dealing with. But that's why I love home birth, because you control that. It's more open for the mommy to say, this is what I want, this is what I need.
Mama, oh, I think
it's more conducive for that environment for the baby to come into, like, that environment where the mom is comfortable and she's home and there's no, like, you know, medical stuff around, no beeping machines and all that.
Okay, well, first let me say this. There are times when medical intervention is absolutely necessary. I don't want to put out there that there are, you know, that the hospital is completely unnecessary. There are legitimate times where medical intervention and being, you know, transported to the hospital, or if the mommy is high risk, that, yes, a hospital birth is necessary. Having said that, I have seen where, you know, having a home birth, babies come out more alert and relaxed. Mommies push a lot more relaxed, especially when they are able to control their environment, where they don't feel like they have to surrender their power over to somebody else. When they're able to say, okay, no, I need to sit this way, or I need to do this with my body, or no, I need to birth in this position. Laying down doesn't feel good to me. I need to squat. When they're able to have that type of control, and then when the baby comes out, it goes right on the mommy, the baby, boy or girl, right on the mommy, right on the breast, and, you know, the mommy is just surrounded by love, then it is a very, very beautiful, relaxing, loving experience and a less traumatic a way for the baby to be born. I have seen women. I have worked with women. Unfortunately, let me say this. Unfortunately, a home birth is not for everybody. If you are coming into this situation and you're not ready to be empowered and make choices and take charge of your birth, or if you're hard-headed and don't like to listen when grown folk tell you you need to, you know, relax and take your herbs and meditate and breathe and do all of these things, then then a home birth is not for you.
Okay.
And then maybe you need to be in a hospital.
Uh-huh.
Because what happens is if you bring an element of fear into the birth, it can impact the birthing process.
Uh-huh. Yeah,
and
I agree with that. I'm sorry.
Go ahead.
I was just saying I agree with that. Because when I had my child, I had a traumatic birth. It was just horrible. I went to the hospital, and they had me hooked up to the machine monitoring my contractions, but they were supposed to prep me for my C-section, and the doctor took too long, and the nurse was supposed to prep me, so when the doctor came in, he saw that I was just still laying there, and he started cussing the nurses. I was like, what the fuck, why is she still up here like this? And everybody in the emergency room was, I mean, I still was hooked up to the catheter in my vagina, and they pushed me while the thing was stationary. So the whole experience was traumatic. My son was born dead for 12 minutes. So it resuscitated. He finally came back, and he had to get helicoptered to Children's because they said he wasn't going to live through the night. So it was just so much trauma surrounding the birth. And then on top of that, he was 11 pounds, 4 ounces. And
had a grown man.
And see, three days before I went into labor, she checked me, and she said he was only going to be 8 pounds, and that she said, just call me Sunday. And Sunday nothing happened. Monday I was on my way to an appointment, and then I went into labor, so I had to go to this hospital that I never went to, and the whole process was just traumatic, and needless to say, all of that stuff, like my son now, he has, like, social anxiety issues because of that, because of the whole experience. And I know part of it was because when I was pregnant, the relationship I was in, I had a lot of fear-based thinking in that relationship, as far as finance, as far as a lot of things.
And so when I looked up my son's symptoms of what he has and what he goes through, and I looked up the spiritual connection to it, it said fear from the mother.
Mm-hmm.
So fear from me was passed on to him.
Mm-hmm.
So this is why I really, really am for all of everything you're doing, because I experienced it firsthand, so I know that you know what you're talking about.
I appreciate that. Well, and let me tell you, the one thing I don't want you, you know, not saying that you are, but by no means should you beat yourself up because of that, because these are conversations that we need to be having as women. These are conversations that we need to be having in the sister circles. These are conversations that as we take our daughters through the rites of passage and we have a conversation with them about being a woman and sex and motherhood and this thing and that thing, these are the conversations that we need to be having. You know, this is the support system that needs to be there. So a lot of women, you know, were when I was pregnant with my children, I did what, you know, I saw everybody else do. Okay, I got to go to the doctor. Okay, well, the doctor told me to do this. Okay, well, the doctor told me to do that. Now, my first birthing experience, you know, I had up here on Andrews Air Force Base, I couldn't tell you what happened. They told me I cussed the nurse out, slapped the daddy. They said I was just going crazy. My son, you know, I was in the delivery room by myself, and them nurses told me, you need to hush all this noise because you knew it was going to hurt the first time. And the doctor didn't even bother to grace me with his presence. The nurse delivered the baby.
Yeah.
With my twins, I had a beautiful experience. You know, I was in, unlike my relationship with the father of my first two children, I was in a healthier relationship. He was more involved with me to pray. He didn't let me, I kind of wish I was pregnant now because I didn't have to do anything. I didn't have to lift a finger. If he could have carried me, he would. So with me, but I had an epidural because of my experience with the other two. I told them, you know, they were like, well, do you want to have these two natural? I told them flat out, if you don't give me something for this pregnancy, I will detour through Southeast D.C. and get a hit of whatever's on that corner on my way in, because I'm going to come in and I ain't going to feel nothing.
Oh, no, God.
I just determined, two babies, I'm not feeling a thing. But, you know, I got my epidural, and, you know, that was a joyful experience, and the babies were in the room with me. So, you know, I use what I experienced as learning tools for other women, and when I talk to other women. Now, let me clarify something. A hospital birth can still be a very pleasant birth, and you can still have a natural birthing experience. When we're talking about conventional, we're not just talking about the location, but we're talking about everything that goes on in there. So you can say, hey, I don't want to be tied down to the bed through the whole pregnancy. I want to walk around. I want to have movement. I want a birthing ball. I want music in my room. I want, you know, I want a water birth. I want to be able to have options on how I birth. You know, I don't want a birth laying down. I don't want my child to get these shots. I want the first thing for, you know, I want the first thing for my child to, you know, feel is my flesh and to be able to be breastfed. I want the lights dimmed, you know. So there are things, but you have to know your birthing rights. And that's what we don't know. You do have birthing rights, and you do have the right to say, this is not what I want, because the one thing that we seem to do, let me put it this way. Yes, these doctors have degrees, but you are employing them to provide you a service.
Preach.
They are not the authority figure over you, okay?
Right.
So you don't have to walk in there like you're applying for a job. They are applying for a job. And trust me, doctors don't make as much money as y'all think, because by the time they get through paying student loans and whatever else, they really don't make that much money. So they need that money that you're bringing to them. So you should make sure that you're going to get somebody who is compatible. Understand that there are going to have to be some level of flexibility because things happen during the birthing process. So, you know, as you make your birthing plan, you want to be able to say, okay, in case of emergency, this can happen. In case of emergency, then, yes, you do have permission to do these certain procedures. But as long as the birth is going, you know, quote-unquote normal, then these are procedures that I do not want to have. And if it's a teaching hospital, I don't want everybody in my room seeing my, you know, my kudukoo while I'm trying to do my business, okay? You teach them on another day. Today everybody's right. got a day off. You know, I want the lights dim. I don't want y'all running in and out of my room asking me 50 million questions. I don't want you checking me every time you come in the room. You can check me, you know, ever so often. You know, so there are things that you can say, and you sit down and you have this conversation as you're interviewing the person that you're hiring to be uh-huh. your primary care provider during your pregnancy.
Right. That's
excellent. The way you broke that down, hiring the doctor, you know, because a lot of times mm-hmm. we feel obligated when we go to these people just because they have a degree or credentials, and we feel like we're, like, under their thumb. But, no, you don't have to just pick this person because you feel as though they have all this, all these credentials and degrees. Do your research and empower yourself. Stop letting people have power over you.
Yeah, absolutely. Now, through my journey of having a blood disease, when I used to have that blood disease, I definitely would go toe-to-toe with the doctor. I didn't have mm-hmm. no problem telling them. And even with the doctor I had for the longest time, we would talk and we would go over a plan together. But she honored, like, the things I would say. We would have a discussion about my treatment. It wasn't, no, this is what you're going to do. And I was like, no, I don't think. We would sit and talk about it. And I mm-hmm. did not do everything they said. And if I didn't, I would tell them. I have no problem telling the doctor they're wrong. Because no one can really tell you about you.
Mm-hmm.
No one knows you more than you know you. Mm-hmm. So you have to keep that in mind when you're talking with a so-called healthcare professional who's practicing on you.
I'm definitely
big on that. I'm definitely an advocate for people really taking control of their own health in their own situation, especially in your birthing process. So I'm really glad that you brought that up, Omi. I'm really glad. That's
and especially because when you look over the years, we're just recently getting all into this new technology of healthcare and stuff. Before that, what were people doing then?
Exactly.
I mean, people were much more healthier back in the day and things like that, because it seems like now we have so many other issues added on to keep us sick, you know, chemtrails, poison, the food, the water, all these things that are, you know, working against us to make us sick. So do you think that a lot of those elements affect our womb as well, besides just, you know, eating the wrong foods and things like that? Do you think that, you know, outside elements can affect our womb as well?
Absolutely. What regulates the womb is the endocrine system, and that is one of the easiest systems to get thrown out of balance, you know, through the chemicals, through the stress, through, you know, what we put on our body, what we, you know, stand in. So, it, you know, and then hormones start jumping around like they have ADD and they don't know what to do. So then you get hormones, you know, a little too much estrogen, and then you have, you know, fibroids and things like that growing. You get the testosterone because of the PCOS and all this other stuff. So these things definitely affect us. Unfortunately, because where we live, we can't uh-huh. control what's going on in our environment 100%. We got people who are way more richer than us and that whatever, uh-huh. and they're doing all of these things. So the only thing we can do is the best we can by uh-huh. eating as healthy as possible, you know, right. by, you know, meditating and exercising and doing the things that we, you know we can do the things we know we can try to have as much control over. But absolutely, these things also impact us. There have been women who live near, sewage dumps that were contaminated, and they didn't know it, and their babies were born unhealthy. Because of where they were living, you know, because of the toxic air that they were breathing. And even this, you know, they got cancer and stuff like that because they were breathing the air. So we're living in a society run by people that really couldn't give two shakes of a hen's butt about how we're feeling and at the end of the day how things are going to affect us. We're living in a society where everything is based on the bottom line, what best feeds this person's pocket or that person's pocket, and we are the last consideration of, you know, how whatever's going on is going to affect. So we do have to try to advocate for ourselves as much as possible and to have collectives that we, so we can advocate for each other and sometimes, you know, be able to advocate for those who aren't in a position to advocate for themselves. Because, you know, I'm not independently wealthy, but I may be in a better position than somebody else to where I can go and do certain things for them to help them. And that's one of the reasons why I teach the birthing options class. That's one of the reasons I am a doula. That's one of the reasons I train doulas, is because my goal is to help women find their center of empowerment.
Now, Mama O, what do you think about meditation on in the sacral chakra? Because a lot of times when I'm doing meditation there, I feel the energy spinning real fast. It was like a fountain or something. Could you explain to the listeners, like, the importance of that particular area?
The sacral chakra is your creative energy. It is your sexual energy. It is the connection to your womb, your reproductive organs. So when you meditate, you're meditating to strengthen your intuition, which also relates to your first eye. You're meditating to strengthen your creativity, but, excuse me, even with all of that, you're meditating to hear your inner voice. And through your womb, you hear your inner voice. You can hear what she's trying to tell you. You can hear the things that you've been trying to, you know, hide because they've been so painful for you to deal with.
Okay. For our listeners who might be new or just coming on the line, could you explain to them what it would sound like to hear your womb? Say, for instance, if I'm a new person and I'm just, you know, coming on listening to you talk about wombs and everything, and I heard you say that, I would want to know, well, what does she mean by that? Could you explain, like, how would it sound, or is it something mental, or is it something that they just have to find out from within, how to look out for that particular whisper from the spirit?
It's hard for me to explain because it's an experience. And it's something that every woman's womb is going to have a different story. But every woman has that inner voice. Every woman has that whisper in their mind that's trying to, you know, tell them what's going on. And for whatever reason, for whatever their story is, they've decided to tuck it away. Maybe somebody told you, you don't have the right to be emotional. You know, stop walking around so daggone emotional. Why are you so emotional? What have you experienced to put you in this emotional state? And what can we do to get you to heal from it? Maybe it's memories. You know, some women have memories from when they were younger and somebody wasn't touching them in a proper way. These are, you know, somebody have memories of things that have happened in their past incarnation. You know, some of them It's all about the voice that your womb has. It's going to express itself, and it's closely related to whatever past or whatever experiences my womb told me, you know, you need to heal from this domestic violence. My womb told me, okay, you need to heal from the molestation and the rapes. My womb told me, you need to stop hating yourself. You need to stop beating yourself up. My womb told me that you need to discover your own beauty and set your standards for your beauty and what you want to see when you look in the mirror instead of having other people dictate that to you. You know, just recently my womb told me, you know, hey, you are better than taking, you know, playing second fiddle to somebody else's parade. You know, let that energy go. So if you're in, you know, situations where, you know, somebody is not honoring your feminine energy, it's okay to say, you know what, I'm worth more. My womb told me that. My womb said, hey, you're worth more. You know, my womb told me that I don't have to carry this burden. My womb told me that, you know, as much as I love my mama, I got to tell her, you know, your issues are your issues. You can't come over and keep putting your trash bag on my lawn. I'm going to need you to stop that and take your trash to the curb like everybody else. So, you know, everybody's womb story is different, but part of meditation is just being able to still the mind long enough to be able to hear that inner voice. So learning how to breathe, learning how to, you know, because we as women, it's some women, some people can sit down for their first time in meditation and hit a transcendental state. I ain't never met one, but that's what I heard. It's not me. I didn't do that the first time I meditated. But for a good portion of us, it's hard to do that, especially for women, because as a mother, you know, when you wake up in the morning, the first thing you're thinking about is, okay, what do I have to cook for dinner?
Right.
And then by the time you get to dinner, you already thinking about, you know, okay, I got to get them to this, this, and that tomorrow after school. You know, when I ran a daycare, exactly. You know, so in the morning, you already thinking about the evening. By the evening, you thinking about mid-afternoon tomorrow.
Right.
You know, so even when I ran a daycare and I closed on Friday, my mind was already running on what I'm going to do for them on Monday. So our minds are constantly moving. Some of us can't even have intimate relationships without thinking, okay, after I get through with this, I got to do the laundry. I still got to, you know, get some stuff. Not that we don't enjoy our mate, but, you know, that's where our mind, because we got, you know, he down there like, hey, because all he got to do is watch the football game after this. We got to still do the laundry. We got to still take care of you. Exactly. So we have to learn as women how to steal our minds and be in the moment and to allow ourselves the right to be in the moment and to feel whatever it is that we need to feel. I'm not saying we have to become these over-emotional, you know, bag of tears, but if you have something that you need to release and it's releasing through tears, give yourself permission to have that experience and allow yourself to be able to discover where that came from so that the healing can take place, so that you're not constantly having these spontaneous, you know, crying fits and everything. So, you know, first give yourself permission. Second, still the mind, you know, work to still the mind. So when we do the womb meditations, we take them first through the breathing. You know, we take them step by step. We talk to them about the posture. We talk to them about the breathing. We talk to them about the visualization. We talk to them about the mantras. Then they learn how to put that all together. I always tell them, if a thought comes into your mind, acknowledge it and release it. Don't sit there and try to analyze, you know, why I had the thought. Okay, this is what happened. I don't know why I had the thought. I'm a bad person. I ain't going to meditate. And, you know, some of us got, you know, little book bears running around who we can't settle down. And so we like, y'all sit down. I'm getting ready to meditate. No, we're not going to do that. You know, you set yourself a time throughout the, you know, in the day. that, you know when the children are going to be in their proper space. Meditate with your children if that's what you have to do. Y'all don't have to meditate exactly on the same thing. They might meditate on Pokemon, I don't know. But meditate with your children. You know,
right.
You know where they are. They're quiet. They're learning something. And so it benefits everybody in the picture. But, you know, that's what you do.
Yeah. Mama, oh, I had another question because you just said something about something I've been going through like the past week, and I don't understand why, but it's like out of the blue for nothing. I would just bust out crying, and then after a few minutes later, I'll bust out laughing. I said, I don't know if this it's because of the eclipse that was going on or the energies going on, but you said something to do so you don't have those crying spells. Could you repeat what you said about that?
Yes. We as women have to give ourselves permission to feel our emotions. Sometimes, whether you just got to be in your feelings for a minute. And it's not that you have to dwell there and be there for a month and be walking around in your pajamas thinking, eating ice cream and doing all that other stuff. No, we're not doing that. We are going to feel what we have to feel, and then we're going to allow ourselves to, you know, understand where that's coming from so that mm-hmm. we can take it to another level of healing. So mm-hmm. your crying spell, you know, why am I having this crying spell right now? What is it that has been embedded in me that I have not dealt with? What is it that my spirit is trying to release? Because crying is a form of release. So there's mm-hmm. something that you've held on to that you are trying to release, and you have not given yourself permission to do that. So, you know, if you have trouble having a bowel movement, that mm-hmm. means you're having trouble releasing. You're holding on to something. Crying is a form of release. Your body is trying to let go. If you have indigestion, that means you have a problem with holding stuff in. So you have to look at all of these things and see what's going on with your body and why. Nothing happens just because. Everything starts on the spiritual level. So nothing happens just. Go ahead.
Oh, I'm sorry. So then what is the last thing? I'm like, I just don't even be knowing what is going on. But, you know, it's like my mood has just changed real quick. Like, and this has just been going on this past week. I haven't been through
what's
this.
What's your sign?
Aries.
Oh, okay. Okay.
Yeah, I was going April 11th.
Oh, you're a master number. And you're a nurturer.
Yeah.
Okay. So that's really not as unusual because number twos are very empathic. So there could also be people in your energy field that are feeling these emotions, especially if you flip the script, because I do that as well, because my birthday is July 20th, so I'm a Cancer and I'm a number two. So, you know, one numerologist just told me that I'm a double Cancer, which I'm just hell on wheels. So just God bless America. You know, but I pick up people's moods very quickly. And so, you know, and it's so funny because I was on the phone with somebody and she was telling me about her man, and you know how we sisters can get when the man ain't doing right and we get the head, get the twisting and all this other stuff. And so I got off the phone and I had an attitude and I was about to fuss, and my husband told me, quit, whatever that was, you keep it back on that phone, don't you bring it over here. And that's because And that's because I was carrying that energy. So what I would suggest for you is you pay very close attention to whoever's in your energy field and see what they're going through. You as a number two have the ability to project your feelings out. So sometimes, have you ever been in a situation where, you know, inside you feeling some kind of way and you notice your environment may be a little chaotic, people around you may be doing, you know, you like, wait a minute, all this going on. I'm feeling this kind of way. And that could be because you projected that energy out. You have that ability.
Oh, my God, yes. You just put the light bulb on, sister, because, you know, this has been going on for so long. I didn't even see that as something I do. But I've been told that I do that, but thank you for bringing that to my attention.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. So I would suggest you, if you wear head wraps, don't wear anything on your head that's dark colors. Stay away from black as much as possible. If you have black on, try to break it up with white. If you do wear a black head wrap, try to wear a white head wrap underneath, because black absorbs. And so you're going to absorb energy. So you want to wear as many light colors as possible to deflect energy. You want to keep a bottle of water around you so that when you're dealing with other people, you can, you know, if you have some Florida water, you can sprinkle some Florida water in your hand, use it to wash your hands, use it to wash your first eye and your crown. Have a bottle of water with you so, you know, you can kind of, you know, get that energy off of you. Also, just kind of do an aura sweep. You don't want to take any little booger bears home. Let everybody have their own business. Give it back to them. Keep a quartz crystal around you. I like quartz because quartz is self-cleaning, and it's a very powerful crystal. It's good for almost everything. So, you know, keep a quartz crystal around you. If you're dealing with a situation, pull it out. You know, just keep holding it in your hand. You can charge it by the sun. You can charge it by the moon. So every now and then do a spiritual bath. That's one thing that I have for my mommies. I make a spiritual bath up for them. So every now and then do a spiritual bath that will allow you to release, especially during the full moon. What we as women, we really need to pay attention to the cycles of the moon. So when you're when you're coming out of a full moon and going into a new moon, we need to be doing rituals that are going to move things away from us. So if you have confusion, if you have backbiting, if you have money problems, if you have all these, do rituals that are going to move those blockages out of your way. When we're coming out of a new moon and heading into a full moon, we want to do things that draw things. So if you want to draw money, if you want to draw love, if you want to draw confidence, if you want to draw blood, do those things. You know, pay attention to the cycles of the moon. Do your spiritual bath. You want to, you know, we get scared of these things because somebody done wrote a book and said this is all witchcraft. Whatever.
Yes, child.
We're not even going to
pay. We were just talking about that, Mama. We were just talking about that.
I've been called a witch so many times. I just said I'm gonna get it on a T-shirt. That's fine with me. I don't even care anymore. It is what it is. And these are the same people that come to me. Can I get a reading? Oh, okay.
Yep.
You know, you want to do things that are going to keep you. And, yeah, we devils, exactly. I'm trying to tell you something. Well, you want to do things that are going to keep you in the cycle of nature. You want to, because the moon is a feminine energy in itself. The sun is a masculine energy. So, you know, you want to draw that heat from the sun because it stimulates the solar plexus. It stimulates, you know, that vitamin D that's good for us. It, you know, the sun kisses us every day. You want to be in the moon because the moon helps to, you know, in that womb where that water is, where it's so fluid, you move with the tides of the moon. Some women may notice that as we get into a full moon, their sexual energy may become stronger, you know. So you want to be able to, you know, do the things and recognize your body, recognize how your body responds to the sun and the moon in the different phases.
Yeah, I've noticed with my body. All right. In my cycle that I started to, when it's a full moon, that's when I come on. It's like I used to come on like the 5th of every month, but like this whole year, it's only when the full moon comes. That's the first day of my period when it's a full moon.
Is this my number two talking?
Yeah.
Uh-huh. You need to pay more attention to that.
Oh, okay.
You need, because, like, why? You can't just be telling me to pay attention. Don't give a sister a clue. because you are a number two. Because you do have that empathic ability. And while you're on your menstrual cycle, your senses are heightened. When that time comes, work with the moon. This is the time for you to go inward. This is the time for you to start examining self. This is the time for you to start having conversations with your womb. This is the time for you because your womb is going through a release. Your womb is taking the time to release all of that blood that is being released from you. Let all of that be the negativity. Let all of that be the womb trauma. Let all of that give your womb permission to release all of that along with that blood. So you want to be able to take the time and do your womb meditations and go in deep and have that conversation with your womb and then do the rituals to bring that positivity, to bring that blessing, to bring that healing into your life. So you're actually doing two rituals, a releasing and a receiving. So you're clearing out the old and you're giving permission for it to be filled once again with the blessing and abundance and newness.
Okay. I make sure I pay attention.
I told my sister I came on last month, and then when we had that eclipse on the 8th, I came on for that one day, and then I went off. I was like, every time something's going on with this moon, I'll bleed.
I'm trying to tell you something. Your body is trying to let you know there's womb work that needs to be done. There's power that you have yet to tap into. There is energy that is trying to open up to you. You have to be in a position to receive. You have to be in a position to say, okay, I am going to listen. I am going to be the student. I am going to listen and hear what you have to say. I am going to obey my spirit.
Yes, Mama O. Mama O, Mystic Feather number two has been told that so many times. So thank you for confirming that once again. We're ready for her to tap in and get busy. You know, we're ready for her to get busy.
You know, Mama O, it's just a lot of fear because, you know, when you
What is fear?
Appearing real. And see, I know all this, but when just seeing things and hearing things. I mean, I'm not used to this. And this has been going on for a long time, but it's just I'm trying to get used to this, but it's hard.
It is. And I just, girl, the first time I saw something, I'm just looking around the room like, ain't nobody else going to acknowledge that over there? I'm the only one, you know? And I was the only one who saw it. And, you know, I had one experience where I was doing a Reiki session on somebody and they, you know, their ancestor was trying to pass information on to me. And I guess I just wasn't speaking quick enough, so they felt like they were going to jump into me. And I had to let them know, no, this is not a three-way. This, you know, this is not a Holiday Inn. We're not going to do that. Whatever you can't tell me from a distance, they just going to have to find out for the damn self. So what you want to do is you don't want to carry that fear because you are a conduit.
Mm-hmm.
So you are going to see things. What you do first and foremost is you acknowledge what you're seeing and you ask them what their purpose.
Okay.
You ask them, and you set yourself every day, every morning you get up and do your meditation. See, that's one of the things we forget, and I thank God for my godmother. You know, she has me doing a meditation every day, and she has me doing prayers every day. And what this does is it sets up your armor. So you call on your ancestors. You call on your spirit guides. You call on your deities, whatever path you may follow, whether it's the angels, whether it's the Netzaru, whether it's the Orisha. You call on your deities to protect you and to guide you. And what they do is while all these things are coming at you, they're on the other side. Your ancestors are on this other side whatever don't need to come your way, they cutting it down because you called on them. You feed them. You take care of them. You honor them. You pray to them. You know, we're scared to do that. But, hey, how do you think Haiti got free? Because they went and they did a ritual and they honored their ancestors. Okay? So once we do that, then you'll start seeing a big difference. And then you'll be able, you have that protection. You have that protection around you to keep you from having to be so fearful. Don't tap into anything that you're not comfortable with. You know,
I haven't been trying to tap into none of this stuff. It was, I mean, like I was like on the last show, I was telling the other sister, like you know, I woke up and I was able to see through my eyelids while they were closed, and I was able to see 360 in my room, and then my room flipped upside. It was just a whole lot of crazy stuff. So, but what I discovered was that it's called astral sight.
Mm-hmm.
Your eyelids or whatever. And so she was, and she asked, was I born with a veil? And I was like, yeah, my mom, you know, she told me I was born with a veil. So she was saying that had a lot to do with being able to, you know, have the astral sight.
Mm-hmm.
But at the same time, you know, in the middle of the night, you wake up and you're seeing that. It's like I'm trying to turn it off because, you know, it's just weird, you know. So those type of things that happen has been keeping my progress stumped. And like you said, everything is just being torn upside down because of it, because I'm trying to get past that threshold, and it's just... You know,
I'm working. You have to do it.
You just have to do it.
You
make sure you take your spiritual baths. You make sure you do your prayers. You make sure that you have, you know, I don't know everything. What I don't know, I go to my ear. And what I love, which is my godmother, what I love about her is she has no problem saying, I don't know, and she'll go and find out. So, and I tell people that all the time. I don't know everything. I don't want to know everything. What I don't know, we can find out together. I'm not trying to know everything. I got too much going on already.
Right.
But I can send you to the right person, and we can, you know, find out information together, because I looked at that as an opportunity for me to learn something too. But, you know, and I'm grateful to have her, you know, guiding me. I mean, I've had things pop up in some very awkward situations, and let your imagination flow, and I'm pretty sure you can think of what I'm talking about. And I'm like, really? Now? Right now? This is what we're going to do? And, you know, they just was like, yeah, I want to have a conversation. And, you know, they come when they come. And so, you know, she has taught me that you have to say, no, there's certain times where you have to cut it off because it can be overwhelming. But these are things that, you know, even I'm still learning how to do. So there are certain things I don't allow myself to tap into just until I get that further training. You know, as I'm on my path to my initiation, so as I get that training, then I allow myself to open up more. But you do want to be careful. It's not fear. It's just common sense, because people who tap into things that they don't know about, they get jacked up quick. And that's not what we want you to do. So, you know, as long as you know your limits and stay in your lane and seek, you know, the guidance that you need to seek, you'll be good. But, I mean, as you open up and as you learn, just give yourself permission to learn and to explore and to understand that avenue of you, because you're not going to be able to shut it down, because it is who you are. So don't run. I don't say all of this to say run away from it. Walk towards it and get the guidance that you need so that you know how to, you know, to function through it.
Okay. And that's
perfect.
What I find.
We're going to go to the line. Hold on, Mr. Feather. We're going to go. Let's take a couple. We got a couple of hands raised in the queue. Okay.
Sorry, listener.
Let me listen. Okay. Oh, wait a minute. What happened to my. Okay. 4703, question, comment.
Hello, yes. My name is Jewel. Hi. How are you, ladies?
Hi. Hi, Dula. How you doing?
I remember you.
Yes. How are you?
Good.
I'm calling because I kind of have a lot going on here, I guess. I just found out not too long ago I'm about to be a grandmother.
Oh, welcome to the club.
Congratulations.
Yes. However, it's just like, how can I go through this? I had my daughter when I was young. I was just fresh out of high school, on my way into college. So my pregnancy with her was, it was like not a healthy pregnancy per se. I mean, mm-hmm. I was healthy physically, but emotionally I was not.
Okay.
During that time, it was like family taboo. You know, I wasn't married. I was a teenager, blah, blah, blah. So there was like a lot of negativity surrounding the pregnancy and a lot of stress because I was also going to school or college full time. Her father wasn't involved. So, and there was just a lot of negative dynamics going on. And I'm just afraid of how that's going to affect her in her pregnancy. Because there was this, like, when she was born, she came out with attitude. Like, you could see, the anger in her.
Wow.
Like, she came out, she sucked her middle two fingers, like, really hard when she first came out. And she lost those two fingers, and I swear to goodness, I never experienced anything like it. She started screaming, she turned beet red, and she actually flipped herself over in the little bassinet thing. And I, because I had a cesarean, I couldn't get her. So I'm like, what is wrong with her? I asked the nurse. And it was like the nurse walked over, threw her little fingers back in her mouth and swallowed her back up, and she was fine. But she just, like, has the anger. I just see the anger from everything, you know? I'm just afraid of how my pregnancy and my experience with her is going to affect her pregnancy and her, like, you know,
like her
womb.
Let me ask you a question. When you were pregnant and having these experiences, how did you express yourself? In other words, did you let people know that you were not happy, that you were not happy with the lack of support, that you were not happy with, you know, the negativity that was being brought to you?
During that time, I think that was the time that I actually started learning how to speak up for myself, because my first response, like from my mother wanted me to have an abortion.
Mm-hmm.
And I refused to. I told her no. And then it was like, oh, well, you know, you got to do something, you know. And then it was like, oh, well, you can give the baby to one of your sisters to raise. And it was like, I'm not going to do that either. You know, so that was like the beginnings of me learning how to speak up for myself, because I wasn't one to speak up for myself.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I internalized everything. I was one of them kind of people that would internalize everything, and then I would just explode.
Obviously.
Yeah, and that is the same thing that your daughter represented. She represented that pent-up anger. That's what came out with her through the womb. The sucking of the fingers was her security blanket. And that could come from all the doubt that you felt from your experience, you know, being pregnant and you know, having to go through what you were going through. But that doesn't have to be her story. If you have not already done so, share your story with her. Allow the two of you to come together in that experience, because you've experienced together. You experienced it together. She was just on the inside.
Mm-hmm.
Share that with her. Ask her, you know, how she feels about this pregnancy. How old is she?
She'll be 25 next month.
Okay. So cycle has already been broken, because she, and I had my baby, I had a diploma in one hand, and 3 months later I had a doctor appointment in the other. So I trust me. So So I do understand. But she broke the cycle because she mm-hmm. didn't get pregnant right after high school. So that's something you've already done. Step one, we're going to break that. That's not going to happen again. Yeah. Step two, I don't want you to have the same experience. So you have the conversation about what your birthing experience was, what your pregnancy experience was, how you felt while carrying her, how she was when she came out. And then you ask her to share her emotions and her feelings with you. These are conversations that need to take place because through her, you're going to get an opportunity to heal. Through you and by you all coming together and sharing this information, that's less that she's going to transfer to her child. And then you're also starting a new way of dealing with these things because now when her child gets pregnant, she's going to remember this conversation.
Wow.
She's going to remember this piece, and she's going to have a conversation. And if she don't, you for sure will be there and say, hey, look, this is what I did for you. This is what you need to do for your child, whether it's a male or a female. This
right.
is what you need to do for your child. Have this conversation piece. You all need to, I would do a releasing ritual to all the doubts, all the fear. Fear is a word that I can't say because we're on Blog Talk, but it's something else. And so, but fear and the divine cannot dwell in the same space. They're going to fight to see who's going to win.
Mm-hmm.
So you have to decide, like the Native Americans, when we choose between good, whether we're going to work on the level of light or we're going to work on the level of dark, if we're going to have fear, if we're going to have strength, you have to choose which wolf y'all going to feed. You can't feed them both. You got to choose which one you're going to feed. And so by coming together and having this conversation and explaining to her what it is that you were going through, what your experience is, and how these things can transfer down to you, you may find out that that you all have some very similar experiences and that those things need to be healed. She may have some questions and be like, you know, I've always wanted to ask you. I've always wanted to find out. There may be things that come up between the two of you all that you may not have known that could bring you closer together in this healing. So I would suggest that you have that conversation with her. Let her know that you support her. Let her know that she's not by herself. Let her know that you understand, because you really do. Whatever it is that she's going to experience, whatever fear, whatever doubt, you're going to understand, even if it's not your exact walk. It's going to resonate with you because of your experience. And there is no one better than you right now who could be there and to love her and to mentor her so that she is not, you know, having this same conversation that we're having. Let her have a new conversation. Let her have, you know, a new situation to deal with. Let's not let her have the same conversation some years down the line when it's her turn to become a grandmother. So you're the elder. Use your life experience as a teaching tool.
Mm-hmm.
No shame.
Mm-hmm. Right. I mean, I talk to her all the time because it was like she went through college with me, basically. So
mm-hmm.
when I graduated, I could just remember her little voice out there cheering me on, you know. So she knows, like, she would go to class with me. Sometimes I even took her to class with me. So she, like, went through school with me completely. She heard everything.
Mm-hmm.
She went to classes. I read books to her and with her. So, I mean, we have that discussion all the time. And right now what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to break this cycle starting with her, because my grandmother was deceased by the time I was born. I never had a grandmother on either side of the family. Both of my parents were old enough to be my grandparents when I was born.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, my mom was 41, my dad was 53. And so I was like almost like an only child, even though I wasn't. And I never really had like a grandparent type mentoring. And like growing up, parents, I wouldn't say I would want to mimic their grandparenting. I'll just put it that way. I really haven't had any good grandparent mentors in my life. So I want to do something for my kids that I feel that I missed out on. So, like, right now, every week, I have my weekly book reading with her. That's what I say. I go over and I read to her belly every week.
Oh.
You know, that's something that no one ever took the time out to do with me.
Mm-hmm.
Well, you know, and I rub her belly and I talk to her. You know, I talk to the baby. We don't know what it is yet. But, you know, I rub her belly and I talk to it and read to the baby. And I told her that I wanted to start traditions or something that we never really had.
But all of those things that you're doing are so beautiful. You don't see you already are breaking the cycle.
Exactly. Exactly.
Mm-hmm. Doing new things. Everything that you're making new is creating something that's not going to be in a cycle.
Yep. Yeah.
Right.
So you're already doing beautiful things. Keep it going. Keep that conversation flowing. Let her know that, you know, hey, and I tell my children, and I got four children, I tell them this all the time, I'm not going to agree with every decision you make, but I'm going to always have your back. I may have to smack you in the back of your head, always have your back. I'm going to always be that one person that no matter what, I'm not going to lie to you, but I'm always going to stand by you, fight for you. I am your secure space, you know, and that's, you know, so just continue to let her know that you are, if she doesn't feel secure anywhere else, you are that secure space for her.
Uh-huh.
You got her. You are the one, you know, that's going to carry her and help her find her empowerment and be able to write a new chapter. You're already doing beautiful, beautiful things. And that's what I did with my children. You know, I was determined that I was not going to do certain things that my father did and that I was going to do certain things that he did not do.
Uh-huh.
You know, and it has created a beautiful bond between me and my children. To sometimes I find them all in my bed, so I don't know. But I mean, but you know, and it's not to say that we don't have our ups and downs, but they know at the end of the day, Mama got you, and that's what you're showing her.
Exactly.
You're doing what you're doing, Jewel.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Thank you for calling in.
Thank you so much.
Thank you for your show. Thank you for everything. Thank you for your support.
Sure.
Thank you. Have a great night.
You also.
Mm-hmm.
All right. We're going to take another call. This one number 5029. Hold on, I'm clicking.
Hello. Hello. Hi, how are you?
Hi. Hi,
how are you?
Welcome to the Goddess Speak.
Good.
Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, my name is Sina, and I have a question for Mama O and as well. I'm 53 years old, and I've already gone through the change. Well, I'm going through the change now. I'm just now becoming to be a conscious woman and trying to learn about meditation and how to cleanse myself. But I have a daughter. She is I have six children. But this one here is 33 years old, and she's having a hard time on having children or conceiving. What should I say? She had a few miscarriages, but they tell her that she cannot hold a child. And now I know she can because, like I told her, if you've gotten pregnant before, you can have children. It's not that you can't. But I would like to know what is it that I can do to help her, to encourage her to try to do something so that she can conceive? Because I see it now, it is destroying her in different relationships that she's having with different young men. And I really don't know what to do. you know, as for mm-hmm. helping her. And I heard you earlier about meditation and right. your wound and things like that earlier on, part of your conversation with the young lady. And then that's one question. And as far as myself, I would like to know where do I begin on helping myself as far as healing my wound and healing myself. And, you know, I this is the first time, and I'm really nervous, but, I mean, I don't know. And I really enjoy you guys' conversations because this old young man named Earl, he's the one that connected me and told me to start listening to the station.
Oh, my brother. We love yeah. Earl. Thanks, Earl.
Yeah. I'm sitting here, I was thinking as you were talking. The first thing I would suggest that you do, is your daughter still trying to, does she still have a desire to want to get pregnant?
Yes, she does.
What has she done as far as healing from the miscarriages?
She hasn't. She just has in her mind, she's the one. One of the ones that helped me to understand and embrace my African culture and embrace a lot of things, because she's really like she says that she's a revolutionary person and this, that, and the other, and she helped me to open up. So what she's mm-hmm. doing now, I can tell that she is working as far as spiritually with herself to get to know who she are and the things around her, and she's a very conscious person. But I don't know exactly what she's doing to heal herself. But in her mind, she says, I'm never going to have children. I'm going to never be able to have children.
Oh, no. Okay, first of all, she needs to stop saying that.
Yeah.
First of all, she cannot continue to say that, because then she's already manifested that that's not going to happen.
Right. Okay.
You know, doctors put things in our minds, and, you know, our minds embrace it, and then we create the environment for it to manifest.
Okay.
So she's going to have to stop holding on to that mentality. What is the physical reason that they gave saying that she would not be able to hold on to a child?
But honestly, they have it. They just, you know, she had a miscarriage. She first got pregnant at the age of 17. And then she miscarried. She didn't try to have another baby until she was like 29, and she miscarried. So they really haven't said. They just told her that she would never be able to have children. And I'm telling her that's not true.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because first of all, if you can't give me a physical reason, don't even say it, because that don't
exactly.
even make sense to me. That's just like you trying to put a fear factor in me.
Mm-hmm.
And now I've been put into my mind, into my spirit, that I can't have a baby, and I'm going to feed on that and let that manifest and sit in my womb. So, no. So tell her that, you know, we're not going to do that. We're not going to do that today. And, you know, let her know, first of all, she needs to heal from these miscarriages. You said she had three?
She had three, yes, ma'am.
Okay, and they happen in the early trimesters?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, and two of them happen, you said, close together?
One happened when she was 17, and then she had one when she was, like, in her early 20s, and then one when she was, like, 29.
Okay.
And she's 33.
She's 33 now. Okay, so
yes.
One of the things we're going to have to do is she's going to have to do some healing. She's going to have to do some healing for the babies that she has, the ancestors that were not able to come through. It
okay.
may be hard for her to understand now. You know, there's a couple of reasons women have miscarriages. That the first reason is because there is a disconnection. There's a lack of relationship with the womb. There's a lack of relationship with the feminine energy. There's fear about the ability to parent, to be the mother. So let's see, you know, how she, you know, yes, she wants a child, but how does she feel about the process? Then if you look about, it on a karmic level, sometimes ancestors don't manifest all the way through because that wasn't the purpose. Their purpose was to go a certain point so that they can hop on and go to their next karmic impression and do the things that they have to do. Sometimes it's not meant for children, for the ancestors that's being rebirthed to manifest into this time and space.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes it's meant for them to just have a quick impression and be able to jump and continue their journey on to, you know, to complete their path, to complete their purpose. We also want to look at, you know, the relationships that she's having. You know, are these healthy relationships? How does she feel in the relationships? How is she feeling with herself? Are these, you know, has she experienced traumatic relationships? Have you experienced traumatic relationships? Have you had miscarriages?
No, ma'am.
Have you had womb issues?
No, ma'am.
Okay. Now, I'm not just talking about fibroids and things like that. I mean, have you had, what were you going through? And you don't have to answer it here on the phone. What were you going through when you were pregnant with her? What was your feminine energy like when you were pregnant with her? What was your relationship with your mother when you were pregnant with her? Because all of these things, and this is not to say, oh, it's your fault. That's not where I'm getting at. So, but what I am saying is that we don't realize what we do because we haven't been taught. These are not the conversations that we're having. So as you do your womb healing, then you can better assist her because you can say, you know what, this is what I was going through. This is the energy that you were picking up on. This is what could be, you know, and then see how that can be playing a role in her life because it may not act out directly in the way that it did in yours. But if you sit back and look at what's going on and you have conversations with her, whatever was going on with you and what you were feeling could be playing out in her life and on a completely different stage. So you want to be able to talk to her and see what that is, and you all come together and do that healing. Have the conversation with her. But she's going to have to do that healing of the womb. And
I know what it is, Mama O. I know what it is.
Okay.
Uh-oh. I know what it is. I know exactly what it is. When you said that, I know exactly what it is. When I had her, I was trying to abort her. That was the first. She's my second child, and at the time, he was my best friend. Okay, and it was just a one time deal with me and him and I, and being a young girl, and a young time deal. We had intercourse, and I got pregnant. He didn't want the child, and neither did I. Not by each other because we knew it was going to mess up the friendship. So I tried to abort her three times.
Oh.
And she survived. And she is, I don't like to use the term my strongest, but she's the out of all of my children, every one of them, all five of them, looks up to her. Even my oldest son. Everyone looks up to her and value her opinion. So, yeah, I believe that's what happened. I believe by me doing that with her or trying to abort her those three times, and each time when I went to the hospital to get the abortion, the doctor always had an emergency, and I couldn't. And after the third time, I just gave up and said, I'm just going to keep my baby.
That spirit fought to come through your womb. Whatever reason she made a choice to come through your womb, she was determined to make that happen. Okay, your spirits met and signed that contract, and you in the physical realm could not break that contract. And so what you need to do is you need to apologize, not necessarily to her, that'll come, but you need to apologize to your spirit and your womb. That is one of the issues that you're having with your womb. That is trauma.
Okay.
That is trauma. Even though he did not physically enter your womb to abort it, that whole episode is a traumatic experience for your womb. You need to apologize to yourself for that and let it go.
Okay.
Because even though you don't realize you've been holding on to it, you have, because it clicked just like that.
Mm-hmm.
It clicked just like that. Ooh. Three times you tried to abort her, three miscarriages she had.
Oh, you got the chills.
Okay.
I got the chills, okay?
So y'all need to have that conversation. And I'm going to tell you something, just so you know, that I'm not judging you. You are not alone. Because when I found out I was pregnant with my son, I tried to abort him too, and he came in kicking and screaming.
Hmm.
He came in, and he, out of all of my children, is the strongest one. But I did, let me tell you a little story, because I did have one abortion. And then a year later, I ended up pregnant with twins.
Mm-hmm.
And there was an old man, old black man with gray hair. They called him Popcorn. Lord, don't ask me why. But he told me, he said, "You've been forgiven. Let it go." And I'm looking at this old man, and I don't know nothing about the conscious tip and seeing this. And say, I don't know nothing about that. And I'm looking at this old man like he must have been drinking. Why is he all up in my face? And he told me, because if you look at my twins, they look completely different. My oldest twin, who I call Mama, she looks like she's been here before. She got the big eyes, and she just looked like, and when she was born, she looked like she didn't even fit into her skin. We believe that she was the baby that I aborted and fought to get back to me.
Wow.
And she came in, she used her baby sister as a catalyst to get through, because if you look at, if anybody looked at my twins when they were born, the baby looked like she was full term. The eldest twin looked like she still had some bacon to do in the oven. She looked like she was a prince. So she came in on the wings of her sister. Even though she was born first, she's actually, and another person told me that she's actually the youngest twin.
Mm-hmm.
Wow. Even though she was born first, she is the youngest. So these things happen to us as women, and I share that with you because I don't want you to think that you're alone in this. We don't know. We cannot judge anybody by their journey, because we not walking in each other's shoes. You Amen. Were making what you felt at the time was a choice. Spirit said otherwise. So now it's time for you to forgive yourself for that.
Okay.
It's time for her to embrace herself and heal from that experience.
Okay.
Wow.
And there you go.
Okay. Yes.
Powerful testimony. Wow.
Thank you for calling in.
Yeah, I really appreciate that, because like I said with myself, I just don't, I'm trying to heal, because I'm trying to heal everything about myself, because I find myself searching for and trying to reach out to my, I don't know what it is. I don't know what to call it, because I really don't know, but I know I want to change the way I eat. I want to change the way I think. You know, I feel like I've just been brainwashed on everything that I do in my life. You know what I'm saying? And when I met Earl, he's been teaching me how to eat right and what I do. But then I still don't have the knowledge to share with others on what I'm doing. Or, you know, the kids, you know, they ask me, my youngest asked me, "Well, Mom, what are you doing?" And I'm like, "I don't know. I don't know." And they, "Well, what do you mean you don't know?" "All I know is I'm searching for something, and I don't know what I'm searching for, but I know that I'm searching for the right thing, because I can tell by the way I speak now, the way I treat people, because I was angry before, and now I'm more passionate. I'm more concerned about others than, you know, so, I mean, I really don't know, and I just appreciate you telling me that, so, because I'm looking like, maybe if I forgive myself for trying to abort her, and once I heal, then she'll probably be, she will conceive. That's how
I'm
looking
at
it.
She will. She will.
Yes, and y'all are going to do that together. And the next time somebody asks you what you're doing, tell them you're on a journey. You ain't got time to label it. You're on a journey. You're doing what Spirit is telling you to do. That's all they need to know. They want questions, tell them to go Google it. For now, you doing what you need to do, what your spirit needs is telling you to do, and you don't need to explain that to anybody. All you need to know is, do you feel better?
Okay.
You know, are you moving through life better? Do you have the tools to handle certain situations better? Are you speaking better? Is your spirit light?
Right.
You know,
right.
You're going to go through many manifestations while you're on this journey. And so what you do now may not be what you do 20 years from now. You're going to be elevated to another level.
Yeah.
This whole journey is for you to keep moving and moving and moving further up to another, you know, as you keep going to different levels. So don't worry about trying to put a label on it. You're doing what your spirit is telling you have to do. That's it.
Okay.
Yeah. Stay tuned and listen to our shows and some of our past shows, because we're helping people on their journey to enlighten and waking up. A lot of people are waking up now, and that's a beautiful thing. It's a beautiful thing.
Yeah. Well, I appreciate you guys talking to me. I will be listening again. Once again, my name is Sina. Thank you guys very
much.
Thank you
for calling in, China.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Peace and blessings.
Yes, thank you.
Wow, that. I'm telling y'all. Grab my tissue on that one. That was.
Okay.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
It was so much beautiful energy with the sisters, all the sisters that called in. I mean, I just feel so overwhelmed with just love and energy and sisterhood, and this is what the Goddess Week
is all
about,
about,
you know, promoting that love of sisterhood.
Oh, wonderful, yes.
Mm. All right, do we have time for another caller? We got a couple minutes, you think?
Let me see.
Not really.
No, I don't see anyone with their hand up, I think. I want Mama O to let people know where you can be reached at. You can let them know, you know, what state you're in, what website you have, and tell them a little bit about your book that's going to be coming out.
Well, anybody can reach me on Facebook. I'm not always sitting in front of the computer, but I do have my Facebook page open. So if you send me a message, I'm more than likely to respond to you. My phone number is 240-422-7875. The only thing I ask is you don't call me when the sun goes down, because I'm done. my main website is divinewaterswombwellness.com. And the eMAG that we have coming out is Womb Magic. And there are a variety of writers. I wanted to bring together a variety of people from, you know, different experiences who could come and share information for the healing journey. So it's a quarterly magazine, and it's going to talk about healing mentally, physically, emotionally, spiritually. There's poetry in there. I'm looking for some, you know, some artists who may have some, you know, digital artwork that they want displayed. I have some wonderful women who are sharing some wonderful information. I have a brother who is going to be dropping some astrology knowledge on us. I have a beautiful couple who's going to be talking about relationships. My godmother, who is going to be sharing, you know, the beauty of African spirituality by way of Ifa. So it's really, I'm hoping that this is going to be something that everybody will enjoy and be able to take something from it. So, you know, for those who may not necessarily have access to certain things, I'm hoping that, you know, this will give them access and help them get started on their journey.
Oh, wonderful.
Beautiful.
We enjoyed having you on the show so much.
Oh, my
God. This is such a wonderful, wonderful show. And the message is so good. And the fact that our listeners, like women, we don't get that information. Like,
what's the word I'm looking for, we get kind of overlooked. Like, you know, doctors just tell us what to do. We don't get explanation really of our wombs. We don't get explanation of really the power of our uterus, what's really going on in our uterus, and how it affects our daily life, how we're connected to our moms and grandmas. We don't really get that information, and it's so important in our own spiritual journey and our healing that we begin to get this knowledge. So I'm so very glad we was able to put that information out there. It's important to me and to the other goddesses because we've learned that on our journey. So, and that's it's a beautiful thing. And can I just get a question in? So I want a doula for my next child, and I will have another one once I get married. But question, when you do home births, do you offer any type of pain medicine?
Sure we do. We offer massage. We offer meditation. We offer movement. And we never call it pain because
okay.
words are powerful.
Mm-hmm.
And
okay.
just the word pain makes you want to pull back just at the idea
mm-hmm.
of something about to come at you. So we use words like intensity. We use words like wave. And you would be, now, like I said, I had all my children conventionally, so you know, I'm thinking, okay, these people tripping, talking about waves. That mess hurt. What are they talking about? But, you know, as I use these tools with my clients and then I go back, because I'm like, okay, well, what did you feel? I tell you, I remember the pain. My clients tell me, no, they don't. They don't remember the pain. They don't. And so I know it works. I know it takes place. So those are the things that we use during the pregnancy. So we don't use conventional medicine. We use holistic modalities as pain relievers.
I love that. So yeah, that was like the burning question on my mind. So, but yeah, looking at it from a spiritual aspect and a spiritual experience and taking it from that perspective does totally change the atmosphere and
mm-hmm.
the experience. So that's a beautiful thing.
For sure.
Yes. Thank you for that. Well, Mama O, was there anything else you want to address or say? The floor is yours.
All I want to say is I appreciate you all so much for giving me the opportunity to come on your show. You're very brave because I never know what's going to come out of my mouth, so I think I behaved myself tonight.
Oh, you did wonderful. If you want to get raw, girl, get raw.
Yes, this is the show for that.
So I truly appreciate you all for even thinking about little old me for being on your show. I appreciate it.
And we hope you come back. We want you to be regular, so please come back.
Yeah, I'm at your service. I'm at your service.
Thank you so much, love.
That's going to be so beautiful because we did a show on the Yoni and it was like off the charts. So we're definitely, you know, we've been called a little controversial, but
mm-hmm.
that's okay because people need the real deal talk. And that's
mm-hmm.
what we're here to provide.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely. So, you know, whatever you need me, I'm at your service.
All right. Well, thanks, Mama O. We love you. We thank you for coming to our show.
Thank you.
And I think we have like a minute left. Anything the other goddesses want to say?
I just want to say thank everyone for tuning in. I hope that they got some wonderful information. I'm so grateful for the caller that shared her experience. Both callers, because they were very emotional. I felt it.
Yes.
I'm so glad for that experience. I mean, the spirit, I just love that. I felt that. I felt that pain. I almost broke down myself. So, we've all been through those things. So I just want to thank everyone for tuning in. We absolutely love our listeners. We love our guests. We're so blessed to have this show to be able to bring it to everyone. So I just want to close out on that. Peace and blessings. Until next time, we love you.
Peace.
Peace. Thank you, guys. This Holistic Gals, and love your womb. Bye-bye.
Yes. Bye-bye.
Bye.